Hi, my name is Mitra Bryant. I work here at Lewis Ginter Botanical Garden as a program developer and educator. Right now, we're practicing social distancing, and that's why I'm wearing my mask. But I'm going to take it off now because my friend Claudine is 6 feet away from me, and I want you to be able to hear me better. Now that my mask is off, let me introduce myself again. My name is Mitra Bryant. I'm a program developer and educator here at Lewis Ginter Botanical Garden. And today, we are going to talk a little bit about water. Did you know that water is a very important natural resource? It runs through you and me and every living thing on Earth, including plants. And if we didn't have plants, we wouldn't have fresh air to breathe and we wouldn't have food to eat. Now, I have a question for you. When it rains, do you think that we are getting fresh water every time it rains, fresh new water? Or do you think when it rains, we are getting recycled water? If you said that you think rainwater is recycled, you would be correct. As a matter of fact, we are drinking the very same water that the dinosaurs drank. The same water has been cycling through our atmosphere for millions of years. How is that possible? The water cycle. So, how does the water cycle work? Well, water condenses in the clouds. We call this process condensation. That means that tiny droplets of water in the air cool down and turn into liquid. We see this when we see dew on the grass in the morning, and we also see this when we see clouds. Now, when the clouds become too heavy with water, we get precipitation. That means that water falls to the earth in the form of snow, hail, or sleet, or rain. Now, eventually, the water heats back up from the sun and evaporates. We call that process evaporation. That means that water turns from a liquid form to a vapor form. Now, with all this water circling around and around, you would think we have plenty. And the truth is that 71% of our planet is covered in water. But here's the thing. Most of that water is the salty water of our oceans. Fresh water, which is only around 3% of the water on our planet, can be found in ponds and streams and lakes and rivers and groundwater and the polar ice caps. But of course, we can't use the fresh water in the polar ice caps. So we need to take really good care of all of our water. And one way that we can work with nature to do that is by understanding how watersheds work. So, what is a watershed? Well, it's not a shed with water in it, if that's what you're thinking. A watershed is an area of land over which water travels to a common destination. We actually have a small example of a watershed right here at Lewis Ginter Botanical Garden. The water here runs from the upper pond down the Asian Valley stream into the West Island wetland, and then it moves on to Sidner Lake. Now, do you know what your watershed address is? Everybody has one. If you live here in the Richmond area, your watershed address is the James River watershed. That means that all the water that you use eventually flows into the James River. So the water that runs down your driveway and into the storm gutter in front of your home eventually ends up in the James River. The water that you brush your teeth with and take a shower with runs down the drain to a water treatment plant and then into the James River. Perhaps you have a small stream or creek near where you live. That water too runs into, you guessed it, the James River. And then from there, it goes to the Chesapeake Bay. You see, The James River watershed is just one of many watersheds in the Chesapeake Bay watershed.
To help you understand a little bit better how watersheds work, I'm going to tell you a story using our handy dandy watershed model. Now, as you're listening to the story, you have to use your imagination a little bit. You have to pretend that these are beautiful mountains. Over here is some rolling farmland. There is a beautiful river that ends up in a beautiful bay. Now, as you're listening to the story, it would be great if you could be thinking about ways that you can make your very own watershed model. You can take notes, or you can draw a picture to remind yourself of your good ideas. We used an old tin pan, some sauce containers, some paint, and some super glue. So, with no further ado, I will begin the story of Kimmy the Fisherwoman. Kimmy the Fisherwoman lived in a town near a beautiful bay. The people of the town were very hardworking. They were farmers and factory workers and carpenters. Now, when they had free time, they loved to boat in the river, and they loved to fish in the bay, and they loved to swim in the bay as well. They loved taking long walks around the bay and listening to the songbirds and seeing herons wading in the water. At nighttime, they would listen to the frogs croaking, and they enjoyed watching the sunset over the bay. Now, one day, Kimmy the fisherwoman started to notice some strange happenings. Some of her fish were washing up dead on the shore. This really disturbed her, because this is how she made her living. Something else strange that was happening was that the water was becoming muddier and muddier. It was hard to see the grasses that once swayed beautifully below the surface of the water. Another strange thing was that more and more green slimy algae was appearing on the surface of the water. Kimmy was becoming more and more concerned. She decided to go on a walk around the bay to try to figure out what was happening. One of the first things that she noticed was that there was a bare area where the plants and the trees had all been cut down, probably to build some new houses or maybe a factory. She looked closely and she noticed that it seemed as if the sediment from the land was washing into the river. But Kimmy thought, I wonder if this is the only problem. She walked next door to a new t-shirt factory. As she walked in the parking lot, she noticed that some barrels of red dye were dripping out onto the parking lot, and it looked as if they were flowing into the river. Kimmy felt very nervous and anxious, and she decided she needed to talk to someone. She decided to go across the river and talk to her good friend, Farmer Sam, about what she had discovered. When she got over to her friend Farmer Sam's farm across the river, she couldn't find him. She figured he was out in the fields. So she set out on foot and walked past his cows. She noticed that he had gotten more cows than he had when she had been there before, and she was feeling a little bit sick from the smell of their waste. Finally, she found her friend Farmer Sam in the field, and she told him all about her dying fish. And Farmer Sam said, well, you know what? I've been having problems too. My corn and my beans have not been growing very well. So I've had to use more and more fertilizer. They need nutrients to grow, so I figure the more I give them, the better they'll grow. And on top of that, Farmer Sam said that he was having a lot of troubles with beetles eating all of his corn, which was causing him to have to use more and more pesticide. Farmer Sam and Kimmy the fisherwoman lamented their problems and they weren't quite sure what to do. Kimmy decided to go home. She drove up the mountain to where she lived. And as she drove, she passed the coal mine. The coal processing plant was known for dumping its coal ash into the river. Finally, she got home. She took a quick shower, knowing that the water that she used would eventually end up in the river and then in the bay. That night, a storm washed over the mountains, and all of the pollutants flushed into the bay. Now, just like Kimmy lives in a watershed, so do we. And I'd like to talk with you a couple of things that we do here at Lewis Ginter Botanical Garden to try to protect our water. So, one of the things that we do here to protect our water is that we plant plants and trees. That's a great way to keep water clean because, you see, plant roots hold on to soil and they keep it in place and they prevent the soil from eroding into our waterways. Right here, we have a beautiful riparian buffer. This is an area around a waterway that is filled with plants. I'd like to share with you a few other things that we do here in the children's garden at Lewis Ginter Botanical Garden to protect our water. We do not use any herbicides, which kill weeds, in the children's garden. We also don't use any chemical pesticide, which kill pests, in the children's garden. And we also don't use any chemical fertilizers, which are actually vitamins for plants. But if you give them too much, guess what happens to the extra fertilizer? It goes right into Sidner Lake over there. So what we do instead is that we try to plant a diversity of plants that attract beneficial insects and repel the ones that we don't want. For example, many insect pests do not like the smell of marigolds. So we plant lots of marigolds, and they're very happy to humans, so, and children. We also try to plant plants that attract the insects that we do want. This milkweed here is very attractive to monarch butterflies. In fact, their monarch caterpillars have to have it in order to live. As you can see, they also attract other pollinators like these bees. In the back here, we have some fennel. This fennel attracts swallowtail caterpillars. Something else that we do here to protect our water is that we use a lot of mulch. This straw mulch helps to keep the moisture in the soil, and it also helps to prevent weeds from growing up in a way that is safe. Something else that we do here in the children's garden to protect our watersheds is that we use rain barrels. These are fantastic. What they do is that they collect water that comes off of roofs, and they prevent the water from running off over land and carrying sediment with it, or possibly running off over sidewalks or driveways that lead to storm drains, which of course lead to the James River. The other great thing about rain barrels is that they give you extra water that you can use to water the plants in your garden and put the water exactly where you want it. Something else that we do here to protect our watersheds is we make our own compost. We use old leaves, old kitchen scraps, old pine straw, and slowly over time, it decomposes into a wonderful fertilizer that we can add to our garden beds. Now, this is a good thing because chemical fertilizers, they often take a shorter time to sink into the soil, and if the plants don't need them, they rush right into Sidner Lake. I would like for you all to think about ways that you can protect your watershed. Please feel free to use some of our ideas or think of your own. Thanks for watching, guys.